Up next on WNJC is a great program with one of our youngest hosts here at the station, Mr. Kevin Storm.
Everybody, and welcome to the Kevin Storm Show. Today we'll be meeting. Today we'll be meeting a tenured academic at a major research university. Let me introduce to you from Rutgers, the State University of New Jersey, professor and well-known author Gary Francione.
Hi, Kevin. How you doing?
Good. I apologize for the confusion in the emails, but I'm glad to have you on the show.
Well, I'm glad, and don't worry about the confusion. Let's just talk about veganism and animal rights.
Thank you. Can you tell me about your educational background?
Yes. I went to, after completing college at the University of Rochester, I went to the University of Virginia, where I got my law degree, and I got a graduate degree in philosophy. And then I clerked for two federal judges, one of them being Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, who was the first woman appointed to the United States Supreme Court. And then I spent some time in New York City doing law practice, and then went into academia in 1984. First at the University of Pennsylvania, and then I came to Rutgers University in 1989, where I have been since then. And by the way, I've been teaching animal rights theory since I don't remember whether it was the spring of 85 or the spring of 86, but in any event, I taught a class on the philosophy of law, and I included animal rights theory, and at the time, in the mid-1980s, that was a pretty unusual thing to do. As a matter of fact, I think it was the first time that animal rights theory, per se, had been introduced in an American law school. Some people had been talking about how the law applies to animals, but the class that I did at Penn, I think it was in the spring of 85, was the first time people were really exposed in an American law school to animal rights concepts and why the laws that supposedly protected animals and whatnot didn't really work. So that was the beginning, and it's been going on ever since then. So yeah, it's been an interesting journey.
How long have you been vegan?
31 years. 31 years, that's a long time. I've been vegan for 31 years. I was, it's interesting, Kevin, I was a vegetarian. I became a vegetarian in 78, I think. After having visited a slaughterhouse, I decided I couldn't eat meat anymore. But and so I stopped eating meat, and I continued to eat fish for another year, I think, until I read a paper in a scientific journal about how fish could feel pain. I didn't really know very much about fish, and then I had never in 78, 79, back then I had never even heard the word vegan. I didn't even know what a vegan was, and it was in 82 that I first found out about veganism, And I say with some embarrassment that although I was in my late 20s, I was not aware that you could live without. I was a good American. I had been totally brainwashed by all the propaganda that I had been hearing for the first 28 years of my life, and I believe that you needed to eat animal protein, some animal protein. So I thought, well, you know, look, I was a vegetarian, but it was okay because I was drinking tons of milk and eating tons of ice cream and cheese and things of that nature. And so I thought I was fine. And then I read that you could live without all of that stuff. And I also learned that all of those products, all those dairy products, are every bit as bad as meat. So, you know, this idea that, well, you know, I don't eat meat, but I eat dairy. So what? You know, there is really no distinction between meat and dairy. The animals that we use, Kevin, and I'm sure you know this, but the animals that we use for dairy are generally kept alive longer than the animals that we use for meat. They're treated every bit as badly as the animals that we use for meat, and they all end up in the same slaughterhouse anyway. So this idea that, you know, I always find it interesting when people tell me, well, I'm a vegetarian. And I say, well, so what? Would you like a medal? I mean, you know, why do you think there's a distinction between meat and dairy? If you think it's wrong, if you think that exploiting animals is wrong, you can't draw a line, you know, and put meat on one side and milk and cheese and eggs and all that stuff on the other side, because it's all the same thing. And indeed, you know, and if you're eating dairy, you're supporting suffering and death every bit as much as if you're eating meat. I mean, frankly, I think there's as much suffering in a glass of milk as there is in a pound of steak. And you know, so I think it's really important for people who care about this issue, that they really understand and understand clearly that if we think animals matter, there are some people who say, look, animals don't matter. I don't care. They, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, they're just things. They don't matter. It's perfectly all right to exploit them. There's no moral issue raised by exploiting them. There are such people. But you know what? Most people don't think that. Most people think that animals, and so that they matter morally. And what I try to do is educate people about the fact that if they think animals matter morally, if they think, you know, if they love their dog, if they say, look, of course my dog matters morally, my dog's a member of my family, if you love your dog, then you're committed to stopping eating all the other animals, because the animals that you're eating and the animals that you're exploiting through dairy, they're no different from the animals that are members of your family.
I totally agree. Where did you grow up, and what was your family like?
Well, I grew up in upstate New York, and where almost everybody I knew, my immediate family, nobody hunted, but most people where I grew up in upstate New York, they did hunt. And I understand, it's not that I didn't hunt because I had a moral objection to it. I just couldn't see the, you know, I just couldn't understand why anybody would get up early in the morning and go traipsing around in the god-awful weather that exists in upstate New York for about 11 months of the year, when you could go to the store and buy dead animals already in little packages. It just didn't make any sense. So, yeah, you know, it's interesting because almost all the people I grew up with, you know, they were hunters, their fathers were hunters, in some cases their mothers were hunters, and so, you know, and almost everybody went fishing. I went fishing once in my life, and I thought it was, like, totally disgusting. Again, not because I had any moral objection to it, but because I just really couldn't see why would you do it. I mean, you know, it's like it was much easier to go to the store and buy the fish already dead and, you know, and prepared for you. But my family, my dad was in the food service industry, and for a while he actually was purchasing meat for a chain of meat markets in upstate New York. So I came from a family where you know, there was a lot of meat eating. And, you know, you have to understand, Kevin, at that time, and I think to some degree this still exists, is, you know, my grandparents all came from, you know, they were immigrants. They came from Europe, and they didn't have, formal education. And one of the things about that wave of immigration that happened in the 1930s and 40s and whatnot was that when people came here, you know, they wanted the, you know, part of the American dream was, you know, having money and being able to put meat on the table many times a week. And so that was really sort of considered to be a matter of, you know, it was a statement of success. If you served your family a lot of meat, you know, nobody was thinking, well, you know, it's really terrible that you're feeding your family meat because you're clogging their arteries and virtually guaranteeing that they're going to get, you know, heart attacks and cancer and whatnot. But that you know, it was a sign of social status. And so, you know, my dad was in the food service industry. He was a meat purchaser for this chain of meat markets, and you know, we had steaks several times a week, and that was a big deal in the neighborhood that I lived in, which was comprised of the immigrant families basically. And so, and you see this now, Kevin. You see this now. You know, for example, you have some foreign countries which have been economically deprived in large part because of policies of the West and the imperialism and colonialism of the West. But now, as they're getting richer, as countries like China and India are getting richer, people are eating more meat. Why do you think that is? It's because people in those countries are still buying into this notion that, you know, when you get money, one of the things you spend money on is meat, and you eat more meat. And it's really very, but anyway, so, you know, I grew up in a very, very different, let me tell you something. When I was your age, when I was 12 years old, if you had said to me, one day you are going to be a vegan, I first would have said, what's a vegan? But if you had said, one day you are not going to eat any meat or any dairy or any cheese or any eggs or any butter or any ice cream or any of that stuff, and you're going to wear leather, you're not going to wear wool, you're not going to wear silk, you know, you're going to sit and read, you know, the ingredients on shampoos to make sure that there's, you know, no lanolin in them and whatever, I would have said, sorry, you're crazy. I would have absolutely thought that was the most insane thing I had ever heard. And now, look where I am. So it just goes to show you never know what the future's going to hold.
I sometimes, my mom would be telling me that you're eating meat and that's not good and it's not healthy, and my dad's not with her, she was raising me vegan, and I never imagined myself being vegan, but I've almost got 1 year now, and
wow,
I'm a lot happier.
It's I wish I had started when I was your age, because you know what, look, I think I mean, I'm 59 years old, and I teach in a university. The young people I teach are in their mid-20s. I've got more energy than most of them. I can't remember the last time I had any sort of cold or flu or anything like that. And so I think that, you know, my vegan diet, which is a sensible one in the sense that I don't eat a lot of fried stuff, I don't eat a lot of oil and things of that nature. As a matter of fact, I'm a big follower of our fellow New Jersey person, Dr. Joel Furman, who has been a friend of mine for 25 years now, and so I feel incredibly healthy being a vegan for now 31 years. But boy, I wish I'd started when I was your age. Man, I'll tell you something. You know, you'll live to be 150, and you know what? You'll be 150 healthy years. You know, it's not that you're gonna, you know, I mean, it's not good to live to be 150 if you're going to be decrepit. But, you know, you start when you're your age, and, you know, you do it intelligently, and you don't eat a lot of garbage, because you can eat an unhealthy vegan diet. People have to understand this. Just because you're a vegan doesn't mean you have a healthy diet.